Seafood's the best in town.
It's the best.
Yes, I can cook too. My fish can't be beat. My sugar's the sweetest around. I'm a man's ideal of a perfect meal, right down to the demi-tasse. I'm a pot of joy for a hungry boy. Baby, I'm cooking with gas. So I'm a gumdrop, a sweet lollipop, a brook trout right out of the brook. And what more?
So, Maria, your grandmother, is it your mother or your grandmother? With a shrimp cocktail.
Oh, my mother.
Oh, your mother.
Yes.
She said that we don't have a shrimp cocktail in America. Explain that to me.
Well, my mother came to visit us here, and we went to a restaurant, and she wanted to have some shrimp cocktail. And we ordered for her, and what a surprise. She said, is this a shrimp cocktail? Because in Ecuador, the way we prepare it is with a nice, rich sauce. And it is made with a blended of tomatoes and fruit juices.
Well, what I've done is I've taken the liberty here of blending those juices and blending those sauces so that we're not giving you necessarily a recipe here, but we're going to make some shrimp cocktail.
Fantastic.
Okay.
Well, we need some fresh shrimp.
Okay, we have those.
Okay.
Put those right in here in the dish.
Mm-hmm. You could
These are uncooked shrimp that have been peeled and deveined and put into hot water for just a very, very short second.
That's right.
Then we're going to cover them with some onions. And as this is Maria's secret family recipe, these are a blend of juices that we'll pour over these shrimp.
And some tomato juice.
And this is some tomato juice. There we go. Do you want to do the
Absolutely.
Honors?
As you can tell, we don't really measure anything. We use your taste.
Your taste.
To add a hot sauce.
Is that the kind of hot sauce they use?
No. In Ecuador, we usually grind a hot red peppers with a little bit of sauce, with a little bit of salt. And we pour that on many things that we cook.
Okay, and then you season it with a little bit of salt and pepper?
That's correct.
We add to that here.
Salt. It all depends on the amount of sauce you have and also the amount of shrimp you are going to prepare. And now you need to stir it.
Okay, I'm going to give you a little ball here. Oh, you can take that.
Absolutely.
We're not making very much here, but this can be done in a lot more quantity if one desired. Now, this has to sit overnight.
Absolutely.
Do you put it in the refrigerator, sit overnight?
Oh, yes. Okay. You have to refrigerate it. And the juices actually cook the shrimp. It's the chemical reaction of the lemon juice that cooks the shrimp. And by letting it be overnight with all these blended of juices, the flavor is really unique.
Then when you serve it, then you serve it with the juice right there.
Exactly, and most people in the United States use the pork to eat the shrimp cocktail. In Ecuador, because the sauce is the nicest part of it, we eat it with a spoon.
And believe me, I tried some of the shrimp cocktail last week, and you do. I picked up the glass and sucked the glass dry.
Hello, welcome to Cooking with Renee. I'm Renee Barbeau. And as you may have guessed, this is a cooking show, but it's more than just a cooking show. We're here to bring to you Central New Yorkers, mothers and grandmothers of all different ethnic backgrounds and nationalities, who will bring to us recipes that we're losing. And tonight with us we have Maria de Lourdes Valles.
Yes.
Correct?
Pretty close.
All right.
Actually, it's Maria de Lourdes.
Oh, de Lourdes.
That's fine.
De Lourdes Valles. She's the director of the International Center here in Syracuse. And we're fortunate to have her here. She was born and raised in Ecuador. And why don't you give us a little bit of background on Ecuador?
Sure. Ecuador is in South America, the northern part of South America. It has three very distinct regions, the coastal area, the highlands, and the Amazon region. We are going to demonstrate some dishes mainly from Quito, the capital where I was born and raised, something very simple but very tasty. And we will also talk about food from the coast and eating generally in all the three regions of the country.
Very good. T- Tonight we're making some lapingachos. No, how do we say that?
Pretty close. Yapingachos.
Yapingachos. All right, and what they are basically is a potato, like a potato pancake, mm-hmm. but they're filled with cheese, and then they're fried in a little bit of a aceitina.
Yes.
You'll have to forgive my Spanish here. What is the aceitina?
Aceitina is actually lard mixed with annatto seeds to give it more color than flavor.
Okay. So that the annatto seeds don't have much in the way of taste?
No.
They don't make it hot? They don't make it spicy?
No. The achote is actually, annatto seeds in Spanish is achote. And they are used just to enhance the, to give color, to enhance the appearance of the food.
Okay. I found this locally at a grocery store over on Seymour Street called, it's another Spanish name that I'm not going to try.
Supermercado La Familia.
It's right on the corner of Seymour and Oswego Street. So if you're looking for some of the ingredients from tonight's show, you'll be more than likely to find them there.
Sure.
All right. We've taken the liberty tonight of already cooking and peeling and cooking the potatoes, and we put them through a potato ricer. Mm-hmm. And that is as far, that's all that these potatoes have in them. Depending on the consistency of the potatoes, you may need to add a little milk. Is that correct?
Maybe, yes. But the ideal potatoes that we find here are the Idaho potatoes.
No, they
are the best ones.
Me.
I'm sorry?
They grow their own potatoes in Ecuador.
Oh, definitely. Yes. We have several varieties of potatoes. But for this dish, the equivalent of the Idahos are the best ones because of its consistency.
Ecuador is a pretty self-sufficient little country there. And they would also be using a different kind of a cheese than we're using here tonight. We're using a mozzarella, whereas they would use...
Well, we will use the whole milk cheese, the equivalent of mozzarella, or something very close to the monster cheese, but not as strong.
This is also just a little bit of paprika that we're going to add to the potatoes for color.
Yes.
So just put in a little bit there?
That's fine.
Okay. Why don't you show us how to assemble one of these yapingachos?
Yes, we are going to show the yapingachos tonight. As Renee mentioned, the paprika is only for color. You will pick up a handful of the mashed or rice potatoes, and you try to form it in your hand. You get a little bit of cheese. You place the cheese in the middle. You close the potato, make it nice and tight so it won't fall apart while you are frying it. Make it a little flat, and then you place it in a frying pan where you have already heated the aceitina, which is, as I said before, the lard with some of the annatto seeds.
Let's see if an amateur can do this.
Of course, it's so simple.
It's like making a snowball.
Right.
They don't have snow in Ecuador, though, right?
No. Ecuador, actually, we have. It depends. In the coast of Ecuador, the climate is very hot and humid. In the highlands, in the plateau where Quito is located, we don't have a true summer or winter. It is like a spring year-round.
See? Okay.
Great.
Then you can fold that up, and then you put that into the hot oil. And then, Maria, you only turn them once?
That's correct. You fry them one side at a time until they are nice and brown. You flip it over and do the same to the other side. That way they are nice and brown, very attractive, and you serve it in a dish. You garnish it with some wedges of avocado, tomato, and shredded lettuce. You serve the yapingachos either as a side dish or as a main dish. It all depends.
So these are what your lapingachos will look like when you're done. Very easy, something to press your company, and they don't take very long, as you can see. The longest part maybe is in boiling the potatoes and putting them through the ricer.
That's correct, yes.
Okay, those are our yapingachos. We also have here, on this note, some fried plantains, right, plantains?
Yes, we call this chifles. It is the equivalent of the potato chips. You use the green plantains, slice them thin, and fry them. You can eat them as a snack, a side dish, or whatever. In the coast, you usually eat most of the plantain dishes. In the highlands, people eat a lot more of potatoes, while in the coast, rice is used mainly with almost everything.
Do they use this particular oil to cook these in for a little extra flavor?
No, really. Vegetable oil is used extensively. Years ago, everything was cooked with lard. But all over the world, people are becoming more aware of cholesterol, and vegetable oil is what is used mainly. So here we have chifles, the equivalent of potato chips.
Now, they eat those all over Ecuador. That's not specific to a region.
All over, but mainly in the coast. If you want to call about typical dishes, you will say that the chapingachos are more typical of the highlands, Quito and other cities along the highlands, and the chifles are more typical of the coast. But all over, you will eat either one of these dishes.
Okay. All right, now we're going to take a little break. And during the break, we'll be showing you pictures of Ecuador to show you some of its many different facets. It's the coast, the prettiness of the
highlands.
It's a very, very pretty country.
Are you from Quito?
Yes, yes. I was born and raised in Quito, Ecuador. The Quito actually is 9,300 feet above sea level. It is the capital. It is located in the plateau. As you know, the Andes Mountains run from north to south in Ecuador. And we have several volcanoes. Actually, it's called the Avenue Volcanoes. We love the view. All the mountains are snow-capped, and you will think that's mighty cold, but it isn't. Quito actually has a spring-like weather year-round.
And where does the snow come from?
Well, the snow stays in the mountains. Oh. Ecuador has four very distinct regions. The coastal area is towards the Pacific. Then we have the central area in the highlands, and each province is actually divided by different volcanoes. We have in the eastern part the Amazon Basin, and off the coast of Ecuador, 600 miles off the coast of Ecuador, we have the Galapagos Islands.
Thank you.
Does your family go back to Ecuador often?
Not too often. We actually go only every 4 years. It's not often enough for me, but it is very far and very expensive, so we don't do it more often than that.
And the family that you have back in Ecuador, what kind of businesses are they in?
Well, actually, I have now only my brother and sister in Ecuador. My brother is a banker. My sister is married to a veterinarian. My brother-in-law actually works for the Ministry of Cattle and Resources there. They also own a farm, so my sister helps with the administration of that.
And what do they farm on their land?
In her land, they farm potatoes, corn, wheat, barley, and the special corn that you use for popping. It's not the regular corn.
Oh, it's not?
No, it's a special corn with very small kernels. It is exclusively grown for popping. It's the different shape, and it has to be dried. The whole different.
It's a different process.
It is, yeah.
Hi, welcome back to the second half of Cooking with Renee. On this part, we'll be making a casserola de manzana, right?
Right.
Manzana. Oh, I'm learning my Spanish, which other Americans may call something like an apple Betty, which is served as a dessert in Ecuador. So, Maria, what do we do that's a little bit different than Americans here in your apple Betty?
Well, I really don't know how different it is, and it's definitely not the most typical Ecuadorian dish as the chapingachos are. For the preparation of this dish, you will core the apples.
Do they have a thing that is a more advanced core there than what we have here?
Yes, we have one that actually cores and slices them all open.
Oh, we have those too.
But they are obviously imported from the USA, so don't worry about it. Once you have sliced the apples, you place them in layers, in either an oblong, round. I prefer an oblong dish. Once you have placed them all in layers.
Claro, we got you what you needed here tonight.
Yes, yes, yes. We have everything we need. You will have the ingredients pre-measured. You need some flour, sugar, cinnamon and mace, and butter. If you're interested in the proportions, I'll be more than happy to share with you. Once you have placed the sliced apples in a layer, you will sprinkle the top with a mixture of the ingredients. So you will have to mix thoroughly the flour, the sugar, cinnamon, and mace. You thoroughly mix them.
You're trying to make a nice design in here too, right?
Don't get too fancy, one layer at a time.
Oh, okay. Oh,
otherwise,
should I take the other layer off?
Don't worry about it.
Okay. I like her, she's easy.
Flexible.
Oh, flexible. Flexible. Flexible, all right.
Absolutely, flexibility. And then you just sprinkle this in each of the layers. Don't make it too heavy because it will burn.
It means I better do some more apples, huh?
Yes, yes, you better have them ready. Once you have sprinkled this quite evenly, you will add a little bit of butter to each layer. In the meantime, you will have to have the oven warming up at 425 degrees, and you will cook this for about half an hour. We are going to place the second layer of apples. I usually put them in the area where they're little spaces left from the first layer. Try to make them a little thinner.
Oh, a little thinner.
Yes, please.
She's gonna fire me.
You better watch out.
Next week it's gonna be cooking with Maria.
Absolutely. And then we will do American dishes. Because at my home we actually eat American style cooking. This is just quite a bit of a demonstration, not my everyday menu.
Right, her family threatened to tell us the real truth.
That's right.
They she sends out for Italian and Chinese on Sundays.
Now we are going to sprinkle this mixture in over the second layer of apples.
Do I have enough apples here?
Yes,
or do you want me to keep going?
Oh, you have okay.
Okay.
You're okay. We have enough. And we will repeat the process, adding some butter.
So do all they have all those same pretty much kinds of ingredients, and
Absolutely.
They grow their own apples there in Ecuador?
That's correct. We have different varieties of apples. This will be the equivalent of Red Delicious or any cooking apple. Ecuador is self-sufficient. We have a tremendous variety of fruits, all the vegetables that you have here. Furthermore, because the country is so small, we are able to have fruits from the coast and from the highlands practically year-round. It is a tremendous advantage that you can always have fresh vegetables, fresh fruit, and meat, chicken. A lot of chicken is used in most of the dishes in Ecuador.
Voila! 30 minutes later, you have what we call a casserole de manzana.
Manzana.
I got it right once. What do you want? We have some other dishes here, too, that we're not going to demonstrate for you tonight due to lack of time. And the fact that one or two of these are secret family recipes.
Not quite. They are just kind of time-consuming to prepare, but we will be more than happy to talk about it.
Right.
The equivalent of the American shrimp cocktail, we call it ceviche. Actually, the shrimp is in the sauce because we consider that the best part of this dish is the sauce. And believe it or not, we don't eat it the American style with a seafood fork. We actually eat the ceviche with a spoon, so you can enjoy every little bit of the sauce. And the sauce is prepared with tomato and orange and the lemon juices, as well as some salt and pepper. You let it marinate. Actually, the chemical action of the lemon juice cooks the fresh shrimp.
I've had a lot of ceviche, and this is probably the best that I've ever tasted. I put the shrimp along the side because I'm a chef and I don't know how to make it. Just that you people would guess that there was shrimp in here without that. We also have another dish over here, which is called the frittata.
Frittata.
When we think of frittata, we think of eggs with a bunch of vegetables in there.
Oh, that's right.
And this is something quite different. It is a loin roast of pork, which is cut and cubed, and then it's cooked down with a little bit of water, some salt, and some fresh scallions.
And garlic.
Oh, and garlic. Lots of garlic.
Yes. The
cooking time of this actually takes about 2 hours.
At least.
Once the water's totally evaporated, you keep frying the pork until it's more like this color than here. Very, very tasty.
And you serve the frittata actually as a side dish. We eat this mainly in the highlands. Also, you have it at picnics most of the time, along with other pork dishes. We like to have it with avocado, tomatoes, and lettuce, or in many other different ways. It's very, very tasty, even though it's the most time-consuming of the dishes that we are demonstrating today.
We also have over here corn.
Well, not quite. It is in the family, that's for sure. In Ecuador, we call this mote, and actually is the white hominy. You can buy it in any of the stores here. We accompany the frittata with the mote or hominy.
Right.
It's quite tasty. For the ceviche, I meant to explain that we serve that with popcorn or fried corn. It's quite typical of keto, especially, to fry large kernels of corn and serve it with the ceviche.
I'm sad to say that I was not able to find that locally, so we cannot show you what that looks like here tonight. This is the end of our demonstration here, but I think that there's a lot of people in my crew who have been watching us cook all night and who want to come up and grab something to eat. So why don't you come on up and get some?
Come on, guys.
Some girls make good taxi drivers. I'm
How did you come to America?
I worked at the Ministry for Foreign Affairs in Quito, Ecuador. And I was transferred by the State Department to the permanent mission of Ecuador at the United Nations. And I worked there for 3.5 years before I met Donald to practice English. And he happens to be my husband for the last 23 years.
You were practicing English?
Yes, that was the only purpose of our encounter. Yes, to improve my English.
Tonight we're whipping. She's throwing things at me from the audience. Stop it. All right. What do you want to call the show?
I want to call it Who's Cooking?
Who's Cooking
What? Actually, I'd like to call it the show Maria produced.
I'm sure. Maria with a slash.